in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, He is for you. Beside you, all around you, and within you, He is with you, He is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, in your weeping, and rejoicing, He is for you, He is for you.
It felt right. I'm like, I wonder if you went back to the amen, it kind of fits. So
it's the same chord, so it works.
Awesome.
I messed up that one part.
It's for you. It's for you. It's for you.
Oh, that's because it's different there. That's why. We don't do it three times. It goes,
I even like the last two I just took out because there's too many on that. I might, for if I'm actually counting, which I usually don't.
Oh, really?
But in the odd time that I do, I just dragged out the U so I know what that means. So.
Okay.
Okay. That's pretty good. Good set. Well, sort of, not really, but thank you. Welcome back, Ken.
Good to be here. I'm serious.
You know, I believe it. Missed you last week.
I missed you guys too. I must admit, I had a lot of fun.
Well, good. I'd be disappointed if you hadn't.
I had enough fun to blow my socks off.
Check, check.
Thank you.
Good morning. Before I continue, let that get fixed. Thank you very much. All right, before we get into worship, I'm going to read a small portion of the Psalms in a second. And then we're going to pray, and then we're going to get into worship. Psalm 43, verse 3 says, "Oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling places. Then I will go to the altar of God, my exceeding joy. With lyre I will praise you, O God, my God." So, Lord, before we step into an atmosphere of praise, Lord Jesus, which you have already predestined and gone before, Lord God, and seen what a praise and worship looks like, God, because you are outside of time. You are not bound by time. You know the promises that you made to us, and you know the exact moment which you will uphold them, Lord God. And right now, we step boldly and expectantly into your presence with praise and thanksgiving, for God inhabits the praises of his people. So, Lord, right now we thank you. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will descend upon this place with silence. Lord God, I pray you'll descend upon this place thicker, Lord God, than the atmosphere of smoke outside. Lord, that we won't be able to move, we won't be able to breathe or live or exist apart from you, Lord, because we can't. Let your presence be in this place. Let it reign in this place, Lord God, and let us be changed by that presence in Jesus' name, this moment and every minute forward, Lord God, that we live and breathe and exist and have our being in you, Jesus Christ. Amen.
That one scared me a little bit. I wasn't expecting that one. But it's still good nonetheless. Yes and amen. Seated or standing?
Power and love. no other name.
There is no other name by which man can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven. Such love as I've never known, I found in the grace that flowed to me. In my unrighteousness, this is why my heart and soul and tongue confess. There's no other name by which men can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven. Such love as I've never known, I found in the grace that flowed to me. In my unrighteousness, this is why my heart and soul and tongue confess. There is no other name by which man can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven.
There is no other name
by which man can be saved.
There is no
temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Oh, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Lord, I need you.
Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
You're
my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
You may be seated. You don't go too far, though. You got to hand out the stuff. Jesus, right now we just take this opportunity, Lord, and give you all of ourselves. Lord, and I mean everything. We lay it down because you already know everything. Everything that has come before, everything that is happening, everything that is going to happen, Lord God, you've seen it. And it does not change your opinion of us that we are worth your love because you say so. So God, first and foremost, we receive your love. That changes everything. God, we lay down the old that has been put to death on the cross, died in the grave, Lord God, and we put on the new that you gave to us through your Holy Spirit post-resurrection, the new garments, the new identity, the new person. We are made new. We own that in Jesus' name. God, and I pray that you will just give us the ability to speak about our new identity boldly, with half as much enthusiasm, Lord, as we complain about our sufferings. And if that and when that day comes, the kingdom of God will reign here supremely. Amen. Lord, new minds, transition, transform, metamorphosis, Lord God, everything that needs to be changed, let it be done by the renewing of our mind and the way that we think about you and ourselves and others in Jesus' name. Amen. It's so interesting to me when you look at the scriptures and you see these different portions in time and these different words and these different prophetic visions. And the one I love so much, and I'm doing something that's bad because normally when you talk about something, you want to reference it first, but this just came to me now, so there you go. But that one vision in the Bible where it says, I am like a wheel within a wheel within a wheel, and there's eyes all around it. I always thought, well, what is that? And somebody finally spoke truth to me. This is how God sees time. Because God invented time. He's not bound by time. Yeah? Remember in Scripture when it says, I invented the day and the night so I can govern you for your blessing? That time is not of me, it's from me. It is not something I am subject to, it is subject to me. If we don't get that subject, I can't proceed. Okay, thank you. Good.
little bit of investment is always a good thing. So if God is outside of time and he sees every event, because that's exactly how God describes time in the scriptures. It's moments, it's events. That's why it's a wheel, it's a circular thing, because it is encapsulating a moment. It is not a linear time pattern. It is a moment that's been encapsulated because there's a beginning, there's a struggling middle, and there's an end. Like any good author, like any good story, Jesus is narrating the whole thing. Why am I bringing this up? Because when we take this, there's some of us here. There's some of us at home that feel bound by what has come before, that the past is what is binding us, and that is my identity. I am no better than the sins and the sufferings that have come before. And Jesus says, no, when I said it is finished, that meant for all time. And what I'm promising you, maybe you haven't experienced the fullness of yet, if you relinquish it to me, and even if it's for the millionth time, and you say, open hands, empty cups, so I can be filled and grasp hold of you and your promises, when he steps in and removes sin, he is literally time traveling back and redeeming it forever, because he is capable of doing that. It's done. It's buried before. When we come and partake, it's a reminding that we are washed and made anew every second of every moment of every day. Think about this. In scriptures, when it talks about Jesus is at the Last Supper with his disciples doing this very thing, and he says, guess what? One among you is going to betray me. What does he do? Trick question. Anyone know? Yeah. What does he dip? Into what? Who does he give it to? When Jesus takes the bread, he breaks and he dips in the wine and he gives it to Judas, does that mean that Judas is any less loved in that moment, even though Jesus knows what's coming? In fact, he's the first one scripturally renowned to be served this. Did it change the outcome in that moment? No, Judas made his decisions. But I guarantee you that if Judas post death on the cross came and said, Jesus, I am so sorry, he would have been forgiven. Because Jesus died for him as much as he died for you and me, but he gets this bad rap, and this is the bad theology that enters the minds of Christians, and we are polluted by it, that, oh, he was damned from the beginning, and he was damned to do this, and he's damned for all eternity, because that's what God made him to be. No! The free will and the choice that we get to have when we do this is healing and sanctification or a continuing of what has come before. It's our choice. I love you enough to give you that opportunity. So what are we going to choose this morning? May I have the service, please? Thank you. Let it rain, let it rain, open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain, let it rain, open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Yes, Lord. Yes, God. Lord, that is our prayer right now as we partake of this bread. And this cup, Lord God, that symbolizes a broken body for our healing physically and a shed blood for the removal of our sins, Jesus, that we allow you to do the work and to be the person in our lives that we need you to be and the work that we need you to do right now. Jesus, we give all of ourselves, we surrender it, and we invite all of you a full apportionment of your presence. Because, God, that is the only thing that matters and changes, is to be in existence and living before you, Lord. To have your face shine upon us, Lord God, and renew us by being in your presence. God, you make us holy. You give to us the divine nature, Lord God, that we cannot earn, deserve, or achieve on our own, Lord Jesus. So we thank you, and we partake of this bread right now, the broken body, Jesus Christ. and the shed blood for forgiveness and removal of our sins. You know, it's interesting sometimes how things come up. You know, I know that we're entering a time of offering and then a time of prayer, but I just feel prompted to share. It's always interesting how the enemy will poke at me, even though the Spirit is working, the Spirit's doing something. Because you know what my first thought was this morning post-worship? It wasn't how good God is. It was in the flesh, and it was, man, look how few people there are this week compared to last. I wonder if I'm saying something that is driving them away. That is the first thought, and God says, but is that really your concern? Even if that was true, is that your concern? No. Okay. So what do? You have to lay it down. You know, it's amazing to me. You look at David pre-Jesus and the prayers of his heart that came from the depths of his despair and the honest vulnerability on display for all people, for generations, including us, that we can relate to it and pray through it to God. It's just, Lord, I know what you want as an offering is not the sacrifices, it's not the money, it's the heart. It's the motive behind everything we do. The actions can be good, but if the motives are sour, which Jesus knows, it doesn't mean anything. I've seen too many people do the right thing for the wrong reasons, and God's like, thanks, I guess. You're not blessing me. You're not loving me. You're trying to do the right Christian religious thing, and that is not what it's about. It's about God. Here I am, even though I'm broken and vulnerable and being real. That's what he wants, because that draws us into the presence of God. So, Lord, as we take up the collection right now, Lord, thank you for everything you've given us. Thank you for what you've given me, Lord God, the blessing of this church, Lord God, that has been a blessing to me and my family, God, that has set me on this journey of discovering you and rediscovering myself for the first time, and you are changing everything. Lord, and the plans and the purposes and the destinies you have for everybody in here, Lord God, we say yes and amen and cling to those. And the moment you say it's time, we want to be able to receive. So make us ready, Lord God. We lay down everything to you right now. Please receive this as a proper motivated offering in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I heard a different take on a very particular verse, and I like that translation or that version of it a lot better, because it speaks to me, and it says, the prayers of a righteous person get a whole lot done. NIV says accomplish much, but I like get a whole lot done. That's good. And Scripture says that because Jesus died and he says that he loves us, our identity is in him. He says, you are righteous because I've made you righteous. So guess what? Our prayers accomplish much and get a whole lot done. Jesus, I just thank you for this morning. I thank you for a new day. I thank you for your love over me, Lord God, for giving me another opportunity, another day to live this side of eternity, Lord. And I pray for your will to be accomplished in my life and the life of this church. Help us to hear your voice. And if we hear it, help us to hear it more. Help us to see your face. And if we see it, help us to see you more clearly. Lord, help us to let go of whatever burdens and baggages we are carrying so we may have open hands for you. Lord, help us to have hearts that are not of stone but have been made of flesh, Lord. Help prepare us to put a new spirit within us, Lord God. Help make us prepared to be a new wine skin for a new wine. Lord God, change the body, the mind, the heart, the soul, everything. Make us new top to bottom so we can be prepared to receive that new living wine, Lord God. Jesus, it won't just be for us, but as you send us out, Lord God, the magnificent fields that are ripe, all the stories and the testimonies we'll be able to share and experience in you.
Oh, we love you, God. Lord, I have such a love for everybody here. Thank you so much for them. I am so thankful for the work that you did in my eldest brother's life last night. Thank you. I am so thankful for the work you are doing in my dad's life, God, that we get this opportunity to share life with him for the next few weeks as he's home with us. Thank you. God, I'm so thankful. There's so many opportunities, Lord. Help us ask the right question of what do you want me to do? What do you want me to see? What do you want me to hear? What do you want me to experience? What do you want me to love? What do you want me to desire, to be passionate about? Lord, reveal your will and your plans. In Jesus' name, God, right now we just pray. We just pray. Any prayer requests, any praise reports, Lord God, we lift them up because we are blessed and we thank you and we are loved by you. In Jesus' name.
We're here with you, even though we're a far distance away. And I thank you for that. You know, really.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Spirit, Lord Jesus, for the work you are doing, the lives, the impact that we can have for your community, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Lord God, we thank you for even our online community, for people who can't be here, Lord, for everyone who's watching. You are still a part of this community, and you are loved and not forgotten. Lord, I just send out your love and your hellos, especially to Rini this morning, Lord God, who's watching. She's in a time of transition from a place, Lord, and that could be stressful. I pray for peace. I pray for joy in the newness that's to come. Lord, and I pray that as she steps into a posture of open hands, open heart, you will just bless and fill her right now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, there is a season of transition right now, Holy Spirit. I thank you for that. Lord, physically removing people from place to place, sending people from one place to another, Lord, a renewal and a revival of the spirit and the soul, Lord God, that's connected to you. We say yes and amen, and we receive that in your time, in your will, in the way you want it to look, not the way we want it to look. God, and I just rejoice in the forecoming of new giftings in people, new passions, new desires, Lord, and the loss, the instinctual, natural rhythm of loss of everything that has come before, that we will just lay it down and it will be easy because something is changing inside of us, because you are changing us, because we are standing before you in your presence, God. Lord, I am excited. Instill in us that new identity. Make us known. Make it known who we are. Help us to step in that, to own it, and to walk courageously and boldly with it. Restore marriages, restore families, restore identities, Lord God. Bring healing from past trauma, removal, Lord God, that we won't even think, that we won't even be burdened or baggaged down by anything that's come before because you removed it, and we will plead the blood of Jesus over our lives, and we will claim and declare that we are the righteousness of God. And we will see that fulfilled because of your goodness, not our determination, Lord God, because you have already accomplished it, Lord God. Show us how. Show us how. When we don't know, help us to call unto you and say, Lord, what do you want me to see? What do you want me to hear? What do you want me to love and be drawn to in Jesus' name? And you will speak and we will listen in accordance with your will in Jesus' name. Amen. We will walk by faith and not by sight. Isn't that good? Okay.
My oldest daughter, the one who came back from Mexico.
Yeah.
She said, handicapped and pain, My daughter's daughter just last week, and she's finding out how she's coming together. And they said, this isn't any of the stuff that you believe in.
Yes. So for those of you at home, Ken's eldest daughter, who was diagnosed with fibromyalgia, is that what they said it was originally? Had a bunch of doctors come together. Ken's been praying for her like crazy, because I know that he and Gwen and Sheila never stop praying for everybody in this church, and I thank all three of you for that. And he said that his daughter had the doctors come together, and they said, it's not fibromyalgia, as we thought. It's after effect of COVID, and it gave her hope, because if there's a sickness, there's an end to that healing. Right now, Lord, we just plead the Holy Spirit upon her, Lord God, that you will do a work that only you can do. Lord Jesus, that you will speak and be active louder and more prominent than anything else, any sickness, any ailment, Lord God, that you will do your will and have your will accomplished in her life, in Jesus' name. Amen, and thank you for the hope restored to her right now. That is a victory in and of itself. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for sharing. And thank you, Teresa. Teresa Farstad at the back there has been taking our live stream services and plugging them into a YouTube format for people who want to watch back later. We're actually in the midst of looking into how to stream through YouTube first and have Facebook second, so we can hit a broader band, have a better signal, and be able to hit all the people at home in a more appropriate way, because we're trying. So thank you for your efforts and what you do. Thank you, Steve. Came to the church and I was frustrated as to why everything was disarmed, and I realized Steve had already been here. Steve went to work and came back. Evan stepped in. Thank you, Evan, for doing that. Don stepped up and helped out with worship. Thank you for doing that this morning. Even if you don't think it's big, it's small, but it's still a blessing. Don't reject that. It is the little things. The little things make the big difference, do they not? When I pray about a parking spot and I get one, I say thank you, God. Because he cares about the stupid parking spot as much as he does about my life. So, thank you. Now, where was I? We walk by faith, not by... That verse has been ringing around in my head this morning. I need to start off with that, because everything today is about establishing not only identity, but purpose in identity. We need those foundations solidified so we can step forward and be bold. Otherwise, we're spinning our wheels on ice, and God wants to give us traction. Yeah? What does that mean? You ever thought about that? Walk by faith and not by sight. That's a scary prospect. That means that we are going to walk around and we'd rather cover our eyes and trust God than trust our senses. Are we at a place in our lives saying, yes, that's exactly what I want to do? Yeah, thank you for the honesty. I love that. Thank you. I don't want to point out Evan, but he gave me an honest look, because honestly, sometimes that's a scary prospect. I heard a word this week that I have to share with you, and it resonated in my life, and I had to confess and repent certain attitudes and approaches to my faith and ask the Spirit to guide me going forward. This person said, if we're going to walk by faith and not by sight, we need to stop trying to cram our belief system about who Jesus is into the left side, the logic side of our brain. Because there's too many people in the church in North America that say, I'll only believe what I can justify in my mind, and that makes you God. And if you're like me, you fell into that certain times, say, oh. Because let me give you an example. What Jesus really is trying to say, what this person is trying to say, and I believe it is the Word of God, is we need to unlock that creative side, the right side of the brain. Literally. Because guess what? Every miracle, every moment where there was an abundance of fruit from the foundation of a faithful moment took illogical faith. Not logical. You can't feed thousands of people by 5 loaves and 2 fish. I'm sorry, that's not logical. You cannot walk on water. I'm sorry, that's illogical. You cannot raise the dead. That's illogical. And Jesus says, greater things than these you will do. The church of God could not have survived from 12 people to where we are now apart from the illogical, uncontainable Spirit of God. I'm sorry, it doesn't happen. So if you're like me and you need to lay that down, say, God, I confess that I've relied on my logic more than I've trusted you. And Lord, I thank you for the logical side, the blessing it is, but I surrender to you. Unlock the other untapped potential in my mind, in my life, so my life can be transformed by the renewing of my mind. Because I want the illogical God doing impossible things in my life in Jesus' name. Okay, good start. This is who God says you are. and everything that follows really spoke to me. And then next week, poof, I'll give a little preliminary. So I've been writing two sermons this week, which I can't do. You can ask Teresa Patton or Adam Patton, my cousin, one of my best friends there. I can't multitask worth spit. Try walking and breathing, I pass out half the time and just fall over. Because I don't want to fall down, I end up falling down anyway. There's a sermon in that as well somewhere, I'm sure of it. God's like, I want you to start studying something. And he took me down this road. And now I'm going to start preaching from Revelation, which is something, if anyone has known me, I said, I will never do. And God says, ha! Good! Let's do with what you say you won't, because I can do what you can't. And I'm like, great, so that's next week, but it's been interesting. And this week he said, but first, let's tell the people who they are and give them purpose in that identity. I say, okay, where do we start? And he took me to 1 Peter chapter 2. And it's just a couple of verses, but this really sets up the framework. This is Peter speaking to us, and he's quoting from Isaiah, which we're going to close with today. It's so good. You believers, that's us, okay? He's speaking to us, are like living stones, are being built up into a spiritual house, a holy and dedicated priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices that are acceptable and pleasing to God through Jesus Christ. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood. He says this again. A consecrated nation, a special people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellences, the wonderful deeds, the virtues and perfections of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Once you were not a people at all, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. He says it twice, you are a royal priesthood. Here's the problem I've heard preached many times. I want to clear this up. The scripture says we will have no other need for a head priest besides Jesus. Yes, Peter's not calling us to be the head priest. He's calling us to be priests
that serve under the head priest. That is Jesus Christ. There is a purpose in everybody here that only you can fill,
that I can't do, that no one else can do, that because of your passions, your emotions, your appetites, desires, because of your past, where you've come from, how God has wired you, He's going to unlock potential if you let Him, because He has ordained you as a holy priest of God. And that's saying a lot, because He's saying, I've done this and I have a plan and a call for you. Can you hear and see me? Can you hear and see me? Because I'm doing a magnificent thing right now for you, in you, through you, with you, by you. In Revelation chapter 1, I'm not going to go too far because that's reserved. That's next time. Lord, help me. Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, and from Jesus, the source is from Jesus. That is the ultimate, the end, the beginning. If it doesn't come from Jesus, it means nothing. And from Jesus, the faithful and trustworthy witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to Him who always loves us and who has once and for all freed us or washed us from our sins by His own blood, His sacrificial death, He has done it all for us. Yes, thank you, God, amen. And formed us, listen to this, into a kingdom, as His subjects, as His priests, to His God and Father, to Him be the glory and the power and the majesty and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Again, He declares us as priests. I want to jump into it so bad, but I have to keep laying the foundation. But this, you're getting this? Who are you? Say with me, I am a priest of God. I am declared a holy and royal priest of God. Amen. You know what Revelation also calls us later on? Kings and queens of His kingdom. That is a statement. You know, my daughter, Bryn, has been having a lot of prophetic dreams, and one of the things she said was she was walking with Jesus not too long ago, and she said, and I can't remember what they said, they were some sort of ministry, but it was the thing she said at the end, and Jesus said that I am now a princess in His kingdom, and He made me a princess. I said, yes, He did. And you know who else He made a princess? Me, but maybe not a princess, but maybe a prince. You know who else He made a princess? Don and Sherry and everyone else here, and you also are kings in his courts, as what he says for his will is everyone else here, that we are called the priests and the kings and queens of God because we are the bride of Christ. And he says, everything I have, come sit at my right hand and have it with me. There is a plan, and there is a huge provision of blessings that follows the life of Christ that is supernaturally imparted to us when we fall in line with his will and walk in his ways to the glory of his name, and we're not relying on our own means. It's good. It is so good. Now let me tell you a little bit about the high priest. See, Joshua in Zechariah chapter 3 was the high priest, and this was his experience. And then we're going to get into another example, which I think is so prophetic and so important for us today, because this is what the Lord was speaking to me, and it's not just because he was speaking it to me. It's because it stood out to me, and I want to share it with you because I'm excited. Zechariah 3, verse 1 says, "Then the guiding angel showed me, Joshua, the high priest, representing disobedience and sinful Israel." Israel is the people of God. It's not just a Jewish nation. You understand that? That time and time throughout Revelation, all these different parts of Scripture, it's not just simply referring to the Jewish nation. It represents the people of God. The high priest, which in this case is Joshua, but in our case is Jesus Christ, who we've already covered, has removed, washed, and made clean our sins through the blood of Jesus. Thank you, God. Joshua here, though, is standing in that gap on behalf of the people of God, and he is representing the sins. It's not a place where we want to be. Standing before the angel of the Lord. I haven't had too many of these encounters, but I would love to see, because these stories are popping all over the place. Standing before the angel of the Lord and Satan at Joshua's right hand to be his adversary and to accuse him. This is a court. He's in a courtroom. He is standing and he is on trial for representing not only his sins, but the sins of all who have come before him. Does this sound familiar? That Jesus Christ took our sins on the cross, and he said, "It is finished," meaning I have taken every wrong blemish from you. You are my holy nation, my holy priests, now and forevermore because of what I've done. But Joshua is standing there, and there's Satan on the right saying, "This person deserves hell," and he's right. But what happens then? The Lord said to Satan, the Lord says, the Lord is speaking a declaration. He has always spoken through all time on behalf of his people. "Satan, the Lord God rebukes you, Satan. Even the Lord who now and ever has chosen Jerusalem, my people, rebuke you. Is this not as simple as a log snatched and rescued from the fire?" That is how simple the salvation of his people is to the Lord. Wow, what a statement. This is pre-Christ. Can you imagine Joshua standing there as the high priest like, "I really picked the wrong job. This is not fun." Because guess what happens now? Now the emphasis goes from the Lord talking against Satan, who is talking about Joshua, who is representing his people. Now Joshua was clothed. We're looking at his clothing for a very particular reason. His clothing were nauseatingly vile. They were garments that stand before the angel of the Lord. And he spoke to those who stood before him, saying, "Remove the filthy garments from him." Now, why are these garments filthy? Because he was representing the disobedient, sinful nature of Israel. And the garments represented that in the presence of God. And God didn't say, "Condemn him for the sins and the disgustingness that is on him." He says, "Remove them. Remove everything disgusting and vile." And he said to Joshua, "See, I have caused your wickedness to be taken away from you, and I will clothe you and beautify you with rich robes of forgiveness. Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you walk by my ways that has remained faithful and perform my service, then you will also govern my house and have charge of my courts, and I will give you free access to my presence among those who are standing here." Now, we don't have to be the high priest. Thank God Jesus is that. But Jesus is saying, if you will be my priest, my holy royal nation, and step into the calling I have placed upon your life, you will have free access to all that I have. You will be empowered with things that are beyond your comprehension. They will come through at the right time. Whether or not you have faith enough to use them, it's not up to you. It's up to your faith in the Spirit of God to be able to use them through you. You will have provisions for whatever is needed. Keeping in mind, this is the same call when in the Gospel of Luke, which again we're going to reference next week, he calls out the 12 and says, oh, by the way, you've been following me for a short time. You've seen all these impossible miracles. You can do them under my authority in my name. Go, blessed be my name. You're going to heal the sick. You're going to raise the dead and cast out demons. No biggie, but that is the standard you need to meet. And then come back and tell me about it. What? But he also says, now don't take anything with you because I'm going to provide and bless you through the means of other people while you're blessing them. That is the whole ministry of the Lord. We don't do it for our sake. We're not doing it for money, for power, for recognition. And God might send you out as vulnerable as the people that you're going to be ministering to, saying, if you trust me and you're going to walk by faith, not by sight, when I say go, you're going to say yes and amen and go. You're not going to take anything with you because I have called you to trust and rely on me. You're walking by faith, which is a trust in me and not by sight. And how can you do that if we're not connected to him? You can't have faith without relationship. You can't have trust without something you are engaging with on a constant basis. You can't. Which means you can't be a holy royal priest, because not because God didn't call you to it, because something is missing and lacking. So where are we along that journey, along that walking path? That was number three already. Wow, we're plowing through this. Good. And this is good, and God has been so gracious to me. Joshua chapter 3, now on the screen, it's going to start at verse 2, and I purposely left out verse 1, but I think it has a good punchline, so I'm going to add it right now just for your comedic effect right now. John's going to like it. Joshua got up early in the morning, again, not on the screen, and he and all the children of Israel set out from Shittim. You cannot say that, you're going to get canceled. But in some cases, where we're coming from and where God's leading us to is the comparison of Shittim, isn't it? And the children of Israel set out from Shittim and came to the Jordan, and they spent the night there before they crossed the river. What is happening right now is they are at the river's edge, and across the river is Jericho. And what does that represent? That is the promises of God, is it not? This is the first time they've finally gotten to the river. That is the only last hurdle that is separating them from the promised land. But it's been a journey. See, keeping in mind that they were supposed to arrive at this place 40 years prior, but because of the hard-heartedness of the people of God, he withheld the fulfilled promise until they all died. Lord, my prayer is that we do not have to have an entire generation of people dying off to be able to trust you and be willing to walk with illogical faith, not by sight, but in your provision, through your leading and your prompting in Jesus' name. I don't want to wait. And I don't think anyone else here wants to wait. Amen. Thank you. Goodness gracious, guys. Verse 2. I'm going to have to get louder if you're not going to give me some feedback. Coffee's good. Get more coffee. Verse 2. It happened at the end of 3 days. Wow, that's pretty significant. Keep in mind, that's comparison. Also keep in mind, Joshua is leading the people. Okay? The baton of leadership has been passed from Moses, who is no longer there, to Joshua, who is there, and he is doing the will and fulfilling and following through the will of God. I also want you to know that it's very interesting that the name Joshua is very, very close with Yeshua, which is the name of Jesus. And there's always a lot of comparison to the symbolism of how God used Joshua in the scriptures to almost a foreshadowing and even, guess what, even greater things that Jesus is going to do. Just look at how he leads and how I'm going to govern him. Guess how much more powerfully I am going to govern Jesus in the lives of my people. It's so good. It happened at the end of 3 days that the officers went through the camp. And they commanded the people, when you see the Ark of the Covenant, which is the presence of God, when you read the term Ark of the Covenant, you hear it this morning, it means the presence of God. When the presence of God, the Lord your God, being carried by the Levitical priests. Declaration number one, if you are the priest of God, and you have to own that, you are the priest of God, you carry with you the presence of God. And there is a purpose for that, which isn't just for you, it's for the sake of all those who are not yet at the stage where you are, to be led and follow God, because you are following Him, and they will follow you. And you will bless them because you are leading them. God is raising up leaders right now to carry that mantle, that calling of being the priests of God, to go forward in His presence with that presence, to be governed, ordained, and used and inspired by that, to inspire others, to lead them to where they need to go. Oh, you guys are quiet on me. Whew. Then you shall set out from where you are at and follow it. That is a second call for everyone. Even if you aren't there yet, follow. If someone is leading somewhere, you know the Spirit of God is on them and He's leading them, and they're saying, come with me, follow. You know the show The Chosen, that intro? That's, my daughters love it, and I love it too. I love the song because it's great, but the visual is all these gray fish, and they're swimming together, and all of a sudden there's a blue fish that turns around and swims upstream, which is Jesus. And as He swims against the grain, different fish turn and follow, and they change their colors too, because they are changed by the presence of Christ. And they follow Him, and they inspire others to turn and be changed, because they are following them who are following Jesus. It's powerful. That's the impact of the people of God. That is the call of the people of God. Spoiler alert, that's you. And then Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourselves for His purpose, for tomorrow the Lord will do wondrous miracles among you. Chills. Joshua said to the priests, and this is great because this is how Jesus will speak to us and how He commands us. This is the instruction He said to the priests. Take up the Ark of the Covenant. Take up the presence of God. And cross over the river ahead of the people. Go before them. So they took up the Ark of the Covenant. They didn't ask questions. What did they do? They responded immediately. And what did they do? They obeyed. So if Jesus is saying, get up and take my presence and go, we need to say, yes, Lord, enable your servants to get up and obey boldly and go. And they went on ahead of the people. They weren't told where they were going or what was going or what was going to happen or what they were looking for. They just went because God is going to say, stop, and here's the next set of instructions when the time is right. The Lord said to Joshua, this day I will begin to magnify and exalt you in the sight of all of Israel, so they may know, just as I was with Moses, I will also be with you. You shall command the priests. Jesus is our high priest. He's the one who's in charge of the priests now, no longer Joshua. Who are carrying the ark, who are carrying the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God, saying, when you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan River. Now, under human logic, it doesn't make sense because you are carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Now, even from this practical standpoint, let me just articulate this for a second. If you're carrying a big, solid gold box, which is the most precious thing because it represents the presence of God. Is gold light? No. What happens when you take a big, heavy gold box and you step into wet ground? It floats, yeah. Lord, we need to go back to the priesthood thing. I don't know. Well, maybe he's lying and he's saying it's float, so you go and you're obedient anyway. You don't float, and neither do you. You sink. So the first part of that already is illogical and does not make sense, the human comprehension. Why would I go there? But God says, because I'm telling you to, and that's enough for me. Go and stand still in the Jordan. And Joshua said to the Israelites, come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God. Stand still. That word means to stand still and abide. It means to endure. It means to rise and intercede. If you are a priest of God carrying the presence of God, and He's saying, go here, do this. Here's something illogical. I need you to be still. I need you to intercede. Enjoy the wedding. I need you to bless those who are unable to bless themselves because they aren't where you're at. I need you to stand in the gap on their behalf. I need you to do for them what they can't do for themselves, because I did for you what you could never do for yourselves. Will you obey the call? Will you be a blessing because you are blessed? Will you give life because I have made you alive and brought you out of my tomb with me and ordained and covered and sanctified you with my blood? I have made you righteous, redeemed, and called and given you purpose. Will you stand up and fulfill that purpose for my people who are not yet? And the people of God said,
amen.
There we go. This is also the same word that Jesus spoke to the waters when they were drowning the disciples and threatening to submerge the boat and kill them all. He said, peace, be still, because Jesus stood in the gap and he still stands in the gap. But I'm getting to that. Behold the Ark of the Covenant, behold the presence of God, the Lord of all the earth was crossing ahead of you, leading the way into the Jordan, because guess what? We don't have to go on our own. Jesus has gone before us, and he will always go before us, so we know that there is a way to follow, because he is always leading. When the souls of the priests who were carrying the Ark of the Lord, the presence of God of all the earth, came to rest in the waters of the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan flowing down from above will be cut off, and it will stand in one mass of water. That's pretty cool. And when those who were carrying the ark came to the Jordan, the feet of the priests carrying the presence of God were submerged at the edge of the water, for the Jordan overflows all of its banks throughout that time of harvest. The waters which were flowing downstream from above stopped, and they rose up in one mass a great distance away at Adam, the city which is beside Zeherven. The priests who obeyed the call, who were obeying the instructions from the high priest, which in our case is Jesus Christ, went before the people obediently, and they stood still in what should have threatened to not only be a separation from where they were called to go, but should have caused them their doom. And they stood still in the midst of it, not only for their sake, but on behalf of the people behind them. And the moment that their presence met the resistance of that water, the water fled, because God was with them. How much more is God going to do with us? With the Holy Spirit. Now, what's interesting about this is, where did that water go? That water was cut off and it went upstream to a city named Adam. Thank you, Adam, for at least knowing that. Isn't that interesting? Anyone seeing the symbolism here right now? Because Jesus is going before us and he does all these things and he's leading us to the place we need to go, which is the presence of God. And when he went ahead of us and he bridged the gap across the place we couldn't go, the waters of sin and death were cut up, and they were sent back all the way to the first blood and the sin of Adam, and they were erected there as a wall, and Jesus said, no more. And we were made able to cross over into the presence of God because of what Jesus did. The symbolism here is phenomenal. And because God calls us to be his priests in light of what he's done, in light of what Joshua called his priests to do, what is he going to do in our lives? We're going to go before people with an amazing, impossible, supernatural, illogical presence of God, and he's going to tweak the way that we think about life if we let him. And we're going to be able to boldly say yes and amen. He's going to call you to the ridiculous and the insane, and you're going to go, and you're going to see lives changed. And you're going to see the impossible, and you're going to see things that you can't accomplish be accomplished because you are there, because God is in it with you. Mel's not here. I wish she was, because she's with the kids. Oh, man. A couple weeks ago, thankfully, unbeknownst to me, God called Mel into a very uncomfortable circumstance for the sake of training and the sake of stepping into this type of faith and boldness. I was at home, I think, with the kids, and she was out doing something. She was hungry, so on the way home, she stopped off at Sunridge. And they got the big eatery there and all the tables. And so she was going to go get Subway, and God said, let's get something else. And she ended up going to Edo, and it was the most overpriced, disgusting meal she's had in a long time, and she was really upset. But it was at a very particular point in the place where you get food. What is that called? Food court, that's the word I cannot find. Thank you very much. So Ito's at the far end of the food court if you're coming from the mall, where the place she originally wanted to was right here, and she would have gotten that and sat down right here. But because she went to the far end, paid way too much for gross dog food, she said, I'm going to eat it anyway because I paid for it. And she went and sat down this big oval table, which is there now, which she wouldn't have sat at before. And she sat at the far end, and there was only one other gentleman there with her, and he was talking to himself. And she's like, I think I'm going to move. God says, nope. You're going to go to the other side of the oval, straight across from him, and you're going to start telling him about me. She's like, great. So she moved, reluctantly but obediently, and sat down. She's like, what do you want me to say? Meanwhile, chowing down on this ridiculous overpriced dog food. Blessing the Lord every bite because he's still good no matter how bad our food is. No matter even if it tastes like where the Israelites came from before they got to the Jordan. Okay, there you go. It's a joke. Thank you. Hey, there you go. Thank you. Amen.
And as she's sitting there, God just says, start talking. Hi, how are you? And he stops the conversation with himself. Starts talking to her, oh, I'm fine. And he's twitching around. And looks like he's kind of coming off something. And Melody's assessing too. She's also a nurse, so she's like, and she worked in psych ward. She's like, you either have something or you've got something. You've got something wrong or you've got something on you. And she starts talking to this guy, and she's like, so what's your name? Gets his name, starts talking about him, and he starts telling her about this other girl who he's staring at across the court, the food court. He says, oh, I know, I've known her my whole life. I've known her, and I want to marry her, and I want to spend my life with her. I grew up with her.
And Melanie looks over and sees the girl, and a lot younger, doesn't seem to come from the same walk of life. And okay, and he says, but now I just have to figure out how to kill her boyfriend over there so I can steal her for myself. And Mel's like, God, what are you doing to me? And she's prepared to get up and go and call someone. And God says, that's my kid. So she sat. She stayed. And she finished this very surface-level conversation. And he left. And she's like, what was that? What was that? He's like, that was training. Because if you can't be obedient in this, how are you going to be able to cross the waters? How are you going to be able to go out and see people's lives changed? How are you going to let me be God in the big if you won't let me be God in the small? And she told me that story. I'm like, you what? Right? Husband mode comes out, and I'm ready to like go over and just like, you were with the wrong type of people, you know? And in my fleshly, humanly wisdom. And God's like, shh. Did you hear any of the story, the importance of how I led her there? I'm like, oh, yeah, right. You think I would have let anything happen to her if I'm training her and I'm governing this whole moment? He wasn't thinking about her. You should be praying for that other girl in their circumstance. I'm like, oh, yeah, right. But that's how God works. That's how God works. And the waters rose up in one mass a great distance away at Adam. You know what I love about the commentary here? You want to guess how far away the city of Adam is up the stream from where they are at, right across the Jordan River at Jericho? It is 16 miles. Do you know how big a wall of water would have to be for you to be able to see that downstream? It would be monstrously huge. And that wouldn't just be for you to see. That would be there for all the world to see. This is the type of ministry that God wants us to be because you are a royal, holy priesthood. Every single one of you. The question is, Lord, will I let you loose your spirit to impact that right side of my brain? Creative sign. Now, for some of us, that's easy, but for some of us, you're saying, but God made me left side dominant. That's great. It's a blessing. He's not trying to kill that, but what he's saying is loose this side from my usage, because I am not going to do things according to how you think they should go. And if we are strictly focusing on walking by sight, not by faith, we're going to miss out on everything that God has planned for us, and we're going to blame him like it's his fault. What this person was saying, too, is very interesting, is that time and time again in Scripture, Jesus uses the side of the right. Come sit at my right side. I sit at the right side of the Father. Peter, cast your net twice on the right side of your boat. It's very interesting. It is not logical. But when God works, it isn't logical. When you go and you feed people you don't know, he's not calling you to do it because it makes sense. It's because you love them. And that is what I see in you and your gathering, your grouping. You are carrying the heart of God because you love those people. And whether or not they even realize it, maybe they will later on down the road, and maybe you won't see the fulfillment of that, he is blessing them. Because you are loving them and going with the presence of God to where no one else is. And those waters flowing downward towards the Sea of Erba, the salt sea were completely cut off. So the people crossed the river Jericho. And while all the people of Israel, all God's people crossed over, how many crossed over? All of them. Lord, we declare that right now, that everybody here and everybody that you commit to our care in the ministry of our lifetime will get to where they need to go into your presence before you. Because we are honoring and obeying your call in Jesus' name. The priests who carried the presence of God stood firm on dry ground in the middle of the Jordan riverbed until all the nation had finished crossing into Jordan. Lord, I declare right now, as we can stand here prominently before you, we say we will stand and go as you call and you bid us to go, Lord God, and you want us to stand firm and intercede on behalf of all people, then let us have the patience and the endurance to stand there with you as long as it takes, so no one is left behind, no one is cut off, but they all get to where they need to go, into a place of your presence, and you can establish your identity and your blessings and your blessings and your provisions and your glory and your calling now and forever and ever and ever. And all the people said, amen. Yeah, it's a good time. Good call, Teresa. It's good. She gets it. One more scripture before we go into this worship song, and I got one more after that as well. No, you come up and you start playing it. We're good. Ephesians, it's not going to be behind me, it's fine, just listen. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, blessed and worthy of praise be the God and Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realm in Christ. Just as in his love he chose us in Christ, actually selected us for himself as his own, before the foundation of the world was even set, so we would be holy, consecrated, set apart for him, purpose-driven, and blameless in his sight, and that is who we are. Because of his love, he predestined and lovingly planned for us to be adopted to himself as his own children through Jesus Christ, in accordance with the kind intention and good pleasure of his will. In him we have redemption, that is our deliverance and salvation through his blood, and are set apart for his good works and pleasure for the sake of all his people. Amen.
shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Amen.
Children and their children and their children, may his favor be upon you and a thousand generations in your family and their children and their children.
Yes and amen.
Lord, your blessings go before us, the promise of your provision, Lord, and the promise of your call and the establishment of your identity, Lord God, and the purpose that we have in it, Lord God, and the lives that need Jesus and the lives that need us to carry Jesus and to go before and to make a way, because you are leading and you've already gone before. You've already cleared the path. You've already promised the rivers will stop. The fires will not overwhelm and consume and divide, Lord God. Jesus, in Isaiah 61, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon Jesus Christ, because the Lord has anointed and commissioned him to bring good news to the humble and the afflicted, to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted, to proclaim release from confinement and condemnation to the physical and spiritual captives. And you, my people, shall be called the priests of the Lord, and the people will speak of you as the ministers of our God. You will eat the wealth of nations, and you will boast of the riches. Instead of your former shame, you will have a double portion. Instead of humiliation, your people will shout for joy at the portion. Therefore, in their land that they will possess, the land of the presence of God, double what they have forfeited. Everlasting joy be theirs in the name of God. In Jesus' name, Lord, we receive your calling and your promise and whatever you want to pour out upon us, Lord. We release empty hands so we can receive. Empty our cups so we can be filled. Give us a new heart and a new spirit within us, Lord God. New wine is a new wine skin, so make us new. Fill us, Lord God, and let us go and follow the call and go before, and wherever we go, bring the presence of God, that people's lives may be healed, sanctified, saved, redeemed, delivered. Because you are doing the work, because you are with us, because we are living in your presence, Lord God. Let the testimonies flow from people of the love of God for all people. Lord, that any place we've had hardened hearts towards a people group or people who have done us wrong, loose forgiveness over us and help us to unleash supernatural forgiveness among them. Soften our minds and renew them, Lord God. Loose and unleash the unlocked potential on the right side, which is your side. Thank you for the blessing of the logic, Lord God, but let it not define. Let it serve us in our faith as we serve you in Jesus' name. By faith, not by sight. By faith, not by sight. My faith is in you, Lord. If I need to be blind to be able to trust and follow you, then make it so. I want to see you and you alone. I want to have impact as you see fit. I want to hear and heed the call and obey and go and have impact on the lives of those who need to know you and need to get to where they need to go but can't on their own. Lord, thank you for using people to be ministers of your will to other people. Lord God, and that is just it. Our battle's not against flesh and blood. It's against the principalities, the rulers, Lord. We come against that in the name of Jesus and the authority that Jesus gives us and the identity that Jesus gives us as a royal, holy priesthood, willing to stand up and go forward in Jesus' name and have impact because Jesus is in us, teaching, guiding, growing, shaping, changing. Amen. Think of the testimony of Paul. Paul has a great legacy in writing us the scriptures of the New Testament. A good majority of his letters to the church, which still speak to us today. Thank you. You've seen how his attitude changed? He got saved, but everything, as Ken has said for a long time, is so brilliant, so accurate. Sometimes the work of God takes time. When you come to Jesus, you still sometimes carry that baggage, and the Holy Spirit works on it slowly. He came first with giving himself the title, the chief of apostles. Elevating himself amongst everyone else to the chief of sinners, to the least of all, because humility takes time. Change takes time. Early in Paul's ministry, when he was called and he was giving this fire anointing by God, he was rejected by the church who could not trust him because they were judging him based upon the past, and he was ready to pack it in. He had early retirement, and Barnabas called him and said, no, I stand with you. I endorse you in Jesus' name. And without Barnabases in the world, there would be no Paul. And what happened to Barnabas?
It's not about Barnabas' glory, because Paul cast him to the side in his early arrogance because they disagreed, because Barnabas was acting as a mercy and grace giver to someone else. And Paul says, he doesn't deserve it. And Barnabas was like, dude, look in the mirror. And Barnabas chose that man over fame, recognition, and joining the ministry of Paul, and says, I know who my God is. And it took Paul time to figure that out too. If that is a journey of Paul, that is also the journey and the allowance of us. Do you receive it? I declare that ownership and identity over a royal priesthood, over everyone here. You have a purpose, you have a destiny, and you impact people that you may not even comprehend yet. And the magnificent and unnatural and superpower ways that are coming are going to blow you away when you stand still in the Jordan and God does the work, saving people, flocking them to Him in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thank you. I was going to ask.
I'm not sure which Jackson, if that's like Little Jackson or.
Oh.
Yes. I just have Jackson's name for birthday. Is it, which Jackson is this? Do we know?
Jackson Ganong.
Ah, Jackson Ganong. Thank you very much. So we got Jackson, we got Bob Farstad, who I want everyone to poke on social media. I don't know if that's still a thing, and say, hey, we miss you at church. We love you. You have a place here. And I'm going to keep using you as a sermon example every week till I see you come back. Because I've given you a birthday gift, so that's okay. And Ryan. And Ryan. Okay, so we have three. All right. When Jackson comes, I'm going to sing happy birthday to Jackson, Bob, and Ryan. We're going to do this karaoke style. So when we get to the names, because you're going to forget them like I do, because I have a horrible memory, we're going to say it. I'm going to say it first. You're going to say it after, okay? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Jackson, Bob, and Ryan. Is it him? I thought, I'm not getting last names anymore. I got it. No. Well, whoever's Ryan's birthday it is. Anyway, I meant well. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Have a great week.